Alrighty, so today I have a little bit of mixed vlog again. I'm here with, I'm making these. I'll start with my handiwork. These are like for, put them under the door or right next to the door at the bottom of it to keep any draft out. And it's kind of neat. It's kind of neat. So you take it and you half it and you turn it inside out after you sew it and then fill it with the padding. I didn't make the snake though. There is a snake version. I did make a few of them. So now I have them for every door in the house. And they're also good for privacy. If you want like no noise, you know, from the outside. Anyway. And then today I've been making little jewelry, little bracelets. So those are kind of neat. I think I'm going to work on these. I don't think you can actually see them very well. These ones are kind of more for blondes. They're blue and pink. Yeah, blue and pink are very, very in pearl. They're kind of nice. They're stretchy, so you can get them on over your big hands or your small hands, whatever type of hands you have. I made a big one for a large wrist and a small one for tiny wrist. And then there it is. And so yay. Anyway, so I'm going to start doing these more. So I'm using Presocia. And that's a really nice glass to use, and glass crystal. And what else? More like, all of those glass beads are pretty much the way to go. Anyway, so what's been going on with me? Not much. I've just been working on the market and listing again my little house rental. I'm hitting up all kinds of people and hoping they're gonna come back with just nonstop visitors that are gonna need my house, place to stay. So that will be nice. I'm, and then because right now I don't want to buy a mattress for my second room, like a brand new mattress, until the people decide that they are going to sleep in that room also. Because I only want to buy the mattress new when they really need it, you know, because otherwise it's just a mattress that sits there. And isn't it nicer to have it brand new for you that when you need it, you know? So I'm going to hold off on the futon getting a brand new mattress. And a brand new desk in there also, because it's possible that you have a desk that's amazing that you have to use, and that would work better. So yeah, I'm holding off on those types of major furniture purchases. But anyway, I am thinking that this whole economy, I know I'm trying to go back to, there's just been a lot happening this week, hasn't there, with the Twitter takeover, and Elon Musk's way about it has been very fascinating and yet very traditional. You just say, hey, I'm the boss, and all the rest of you, what was it, 9 CEOs are fired. And yes, it's no $42 million compensation for you, Aratel, I believe his name was. And so that's probably going to go to court. But the whole point there is, and my hen is eating, and she's really, really, she's not very happy at the moment. She kind of still laying eggs, and they're not ever becoming chicks, and. She's wondering, what has this life been about? You know, lay egg, lay egg, lay egg, and never get a chick. So just stupid, you know. So she's kind of in one of those moods. So back to this discussion of what the 9 CEOs have been fired. Well, they probably have, maybe they have hair. I don't know. Does money make you feel loved? Because they probably did make a bunch of money. They probably made how much money? Probably 5 million each minimum. So I have a feeling and that they just made, you know, buku bucks. And so now this guy, this one man is saying it's a one man band. And in a way, I applaud it because I believe a lot of these tech companies in specific have gone overboard. They've said, oh, we need all of these guys, all these people. And it just turns into a government, a situation. When you have a company that's become a government situation, you end up with something called bloat. And that bloat is gonna be like, things aren't accomplished as quickly. Things are just not going, you're not going from the horse's mouth to the accomplishment fact. You're going from, oh, the horse's mouth is way over there, way over there, way over there, way over there. You never actually get to that person, do you? So when you take it and use, and you know who else does this feature, this way a lot is Warren Buffett with his furniture store in Nebraska. He's taken the hold of it, you know, many, many years. I'm not sure if he's doing that any longer. You know, he's very retired, but you know, it's been his store. And so you know, you take that and it's just like, you know, you have to run things by him. And that's just the way it goes. And so all of this namby-pamby, well, maybe this guy will let me get going through, or this one will work through that one. You know, you have 9 CEOs. You think of all the diversions of the people. I really get along with that one better than with this one. And so I'm going to say only certain things to this one that I get along with, and only certain things to that one that I don't get along with very well. So when I want to push my particular policy or whatever, I'm going to go to that one, you know. So you have having all this sneaky, backhanded going on, and it starts to become, guess what, like the U.S. government, one big crazy wheel that goes around, and whoever is actually nominated, whose efforts put in office, what happens? Well, and they get to turn the wheel their way. That's really what it's about. They get to turn the wheel in their direction. And if they have enough people turning the wheel in their direction, then the wheel gets to move more. If they only have half the people in one direction and half the other, then it's just a lock, isn't it? It doesn't go. But you have all these people trying to change the rules each 4 years, each 6 years, each 2 years, whether it's the House, the Senate, or the President. So they're in there, and then the judiciary, they're all trying to change the rules their way, their type of manipulation. You know, they're all manipulators. Politicians are manipulators. And so, anyway, so in this, when you have a one person, and you may not like all of his policies, but you have to realize the downsizing effect, the streamline effect. So it's extremely much more, when you think of it as a company, it's a company that you can approach, that you can see decisions actually be made and accomplished, and it hasn't become a big gross overdone. So it's actually my advice for the other tech companies specifically, because they're so flip-floppy, like belly flopping, is to follow the same approach. And obviously, you know, the whole time, unfortunately, that that man or woman is in charge of that company, there's going to be people trying to tug at their penguin tails and say, no, you're nutty. You're sick in the head. You're playing goof. We don't want that. And that, you know, give you paranoia behind your back. So all of that's going to be going on. And they'll probably even try to write old Elon up as a nutter. And they probably already have written the nutter papers. I'm not at all in disbelief of that, especially when there's so much money on the line. And even the fact that, well, you're unstable, you've lost $110 billion. And same with Zuckerberg. I'm not good with his name, but Zucker. Or probably related, but it doesn't matter. I'm still not good with your name. But I know it's Mark, and I know that you play with routing a lot. Okay, so in your metas, you have lost a bundle of cash, and biggest bundle of cash loss in history for a human being, apparently. Well, you know, try to relax. It's not the end of the world. And if you gave a portion to everybody, it would only be like $10 each. So just relax on that fact. It was not that much money to each person. So when everybody's yelling at you, you lost $100 billion. Or actually, yeah, I'm sorry, I got it wrong. I believe it was Zuckerberg who lost the 110 and Musk who lost the 60,000 or so, as the 60 billion this year. And I didn't do the overall event, but yeah, like together it amassed to like a trillion. And then Bezos was involved. Everybody was involved. But when you look at the stats, we will go back this year and go, who was the one who lost the least? And the loser of the least was Warren Buffett. Okay, so Warren Buffett, what did you do that you on your little bar chart only fell this much and the rest of those boys fell like a huge amount? What did you do? Because we're like, did you use stops on your trade? Did you use a stop out like $8 or 8%? What did you do? I mean, we're desperate to know. That's a huge amount of money and difference. We're talking 3, 4, 5, 6 times the amount of what Warren Buffett lost. So in a way, we need to ask Warren Buffett, what was his trading technique? Because money really is an important mover in this world. And when people are that rich, and yes, Bill Gates, you lost a bundle. When people are that rich and they lose $500 billion, $1 trillion in 1 year, it affects our economy. It affects the economy of all kinds of people. It trickles down in the worst ways. We actually need, at this monster that we have, we needed their stability. We didn't need them to fall. Okay, and unfortunately, we're like, well, can't we spread the wealth? Everybody wants the wealth spread. Yeah, we know this. We know we want equality. But right now, that is not in place. And you see when it all falls off the wall, all the Humpty Dumpties fall, that we're in a really bad situation because everything starts to Humpty Dumpty fall off the wall. You know, people who have a house that's worth $100,000, they can't make their payments. So it works all across the board. So Buffett was the winner. So in a trading scheme, we need him to disclose, because that's $1 trillion of, and I don't believe they're irresponsible men. I don't believe they're irresponsible at all to lose that amount. I believe they had no idea how it could fall that much. What were they doing? You know, what were they doing? And was it just their technique? Don't say I am the one who's the greatest here, because I'm barely holding on with my account. But I started my account at $10,000, and it's still perched near that amount after all of the bear, after everything. So I personally have actually not lost that much on a scale of when I started my profit only trade. Okay, when I started that one, I've done pretty well. But this whole thing took me out from about a month and a half of ACATing around. So I couldn't do anything. So right now I'm just staring at a bunch of dollars. And so I may not be trading anymore because of that takeaway of a month and a half during a very important time. So anyway, so the star though is not me. The star is Warren Buffett. And so we need those who are the smarts, those who know him well. I've never met Warren Buffett. My father worked for him and knew him and went on plane journeys with his brother. But no, I never met him. When it comes to who has that ability to say, how are you doing it? Where are his friends? We need to pull them out to the major news and share that trading technique, because that is not something that we need to be hiding. And no, it's not just Berkshire Hathaway either. I know he trades other things. I know he's not just Home Depot, but he does trade a vast selection of stocks, but his technique is definitely needed to be known. Okay, anything else? Disappointment in U.S. government. I have so much disappointment in the U.S. government. I'm even afraid to look up my town that I'm living in under the news. I've literally come to the point that I'm afraid to look it up, because such a devastation of influx has happened here that it's akin to destroying a viable community. So we feel tricked, betrayed. We're very betrayed here. And it betrays also, not only does it betray us as a community, it betrays what fragile, and I will say fragile, it's a very fragile community of what do we call ourselves over there, the Native Americans, the Mexican Americans, versus the white, the black, the military. Okay, so those, it's a fragile group, and we're not always getting along anyway. So when you bring in more of this, more of the minority switch, I'll call it, when you bring that in, all the whites here put up their signs and sold and moved. You know, in their minds, they're like, I've got to get out. You know, they're feeling danger. They're like, I didn't want to move to Mexico. I didn't want that. I'm scared. You know, I don't want to put a glass on all of my fences, barbed wire, you know, stuck into the cement. You know, I don't want that. You know, that's what they're all thinking, and you can't blame them. And my neighbor's gone. She's gone. Probably went off back to the Ozarks or Tennessee. but she's gone. Moved out of her house. And that's that. You know, and so they've damaged this community because of the fragile relationship between the whites, the blacks, and the Chihuahuans, you know, we get along, but when you're faced with this much, it's just like, wait a minute, I don't know if I trust you. You could be one of the new. You know what I'm saying? You could be one of the new. So when I have somebody at my door and they want to rent a room, I'm questioning, are you one of the new? Are you like a Venezuelan like drug dealer or something? I don't really know. Yeah, I've lost faith. And you could very easily be that. So yeah, they've damaged El Paso. Anyway, I'm going to sign off.